It's great to see everybody here today. I know it's a very busy time of the semester, post-convocation, and also I know a lot of folks are struggling with feeling under the weather. It seems like lots of stuff's going around this part of the country, so I appreciate your being here, and thank you for being engaged in worship today. Our special guest today, I saw him preach for the first time about 2 years ago. He was preaching on the television, and I was immediately convinced that we had to have him here in our chapel. He has pastored around the South in several states for 22 years, and when pastoring in Atlanta, the church he pastored before where he is right now, he founded a community-based ministry that featured a youth activity center, a barbershop, things like a beauty salon, a clothing ministry, and a food pantry. During his pastorate, the church there received a $5.2 million federal grant to construct housing for older adults. He is now the senior pastor at Oakwood University Church in Huntsville, Alabama. Since being there, he has led the construction of a new K-12 academy. And he also doubles as the speaker and director of Breath of Life television broadcasts. He's received numerous honors, one of which he received 9 years ago. He was inducted into the Martin Luther King Board of Preachers at Morehouse College. He's been married to his wife of 19 years, and they have 3 daughters. This guy is an inspiring communicator. If you would, please help me welcome to Lee University, Dr. Carlton Byrd.
Thank you so much. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, Dr. Hayes. I think I'm going to take you with me on the road. We have another appointment in Collegedale Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and so I may have to call on you to introduce me. You did that very well, like we had known each other for 50 years. The reality is I'm not even 50 years old, so you know you've done a great job. But I'm grateful to be here today. Thank you, Dr. Hayes, Dr. Harper, our pastor, as well as our president, Dr. Khan, and to the most prized possession here at Lee University, our students. Give yourselves a big round of applause this morning. I'm grateful to be here. I felt right at home during praise and worship. I said to myself, okay, I can get with this. This is good. This is good. This is good. And so I thank and I praise God. Now, I've been told I have a specific amount of time. And so with that, I want to be true to that time because I would say, let me see, I went to school 27 years ago when I was in college. I sat where you sit, and in sitting where you sit, I always used to say when it was assembly, when it was chapel, please let the speaker or the presenter stay in the time parameters. Come on, say amen. And so I'm going to do that for you this morning, but I want to share something with you that I believe the Lord has given me to give you. And so before I talk with you, let's first talk with God. Our Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for waking me up. Thank you for allowing me safe travel to Cleveland, Tennessee, to Lee University today. Now, oh Father, breathe on me to breathe as you breathe on your people. Speak to me to speak to your people, that your people not hear me, but hear thee. And God, we be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In the name of Jesus, we pray, let everyone say amen. Amen. Excellence. That's what I want to talk to you about today. Excellence. And if you have your Bibles, maybe you have it on your smartphone or iPad or whatnot, you can turn with me to the book of Colossians. And I want to go to Colossians, and I want to go to the third chapter. Colossians chapter 3, and I want to read verses 23 and 24. Colossians chapter 3. Verses 23 and 24, the word of God says, and whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Now I just read that from the King James Version. Let me read it one more time. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Now, I like the way the contemporary English version puts it. It says, do your work willingly, as though you were serving the Lord himself and not just your earthly master. In fact, the Lord is the one you are really serving, and you know that he will reward you. But then the Good News Translation says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as though you were working for the Lord and not for people. Remember that the Lord will give you as a reward what he has kept for his people. For Christ is the real master you serve. Story is told of a man who once visited a church under construction where he saw a sculptor making an image of Jesus Christ. Suddenly, he noticed nearby a similar image lying there, and he asked the sculptor, he said, "Sir, do you need two statues of the same image?" "No," the sculptor said without looking up, "we only need one, but the first one got damaged a little earlier." The gentleman examined the image and found no apparent damage. So he asked, "Well, where's the damage?" He said, "There's a scratch on the nose of the image," the sculptor said. So still busy, still doing his work, he never looked up. The man then asked, "Well, where are you going to install the new image?" The sculptor replied that it would be installed on a pillar 20 feet high in the air. The man then said, "Well, if the image is that far up in the air, who's going to know in the first place that there's even a scratch on the nose?" The sculptor then stopped his work. He looked up at the man who was asking him all these questions, and he smiled and he said, "I will." Moral of the story, the desire to excel has nothing to do with whether someone appreciates it or not. Excellence is a drive from the inside, not the outside. Excellence is not for someone else to notice, but it's for you and your own satisfaction. If you are content with the best you've done, you will never become the best that you can be. Excellence is not an exception. Excellence is a prevailing attitude. And in our world today, be it at home, be it here at school, be it with our families, be it on the job, be it even in the church, mediocrity has become the norm. But the difference between mediocrity and excellence is a matter of effort. God's people must strive the very best to attain excellence in all that they do. The text we've read says, "And whatever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men." Today, our students here at Lee University, if you're going to make a difference in our world, you must epitomize excellence. The question then can be asked, well, does excellence even matter to God? Does God even care about quality? Is God even concerned with how well things are done? Some would say, no, God only cares about our hearts, and it's the thought that counts. What matters to him are things like love and compassion and forgiveness. And yes, to a point, that's true. Yes, it is. But God is also, yes, primarily concerned with our hearts. But God does care about those things that are expressions of our hearts. Because the way we serve God in our church, here at school, in our homes, on our jobs, in our neighborhoods, in our communities, the way we live out our faith, the level of commitment we have to doing things well, to honoring God in every area of our lives, reveals what's in our hearts. Friends of mine, it's not the things themselves God cares about, it's what those things say about our hearts. So why do we even strive for excellence? Why are we even here trying to get an education? We should strive for excellence because God deserves our best. The psalmist said it best, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. His greatness is unsearchable." What we do, and when we do our work as unto the Lord, it sets us apart. It sets it apart as eternal work. Let me be clear this morning. Our boss, our employer, our supervisor is the Lord. I'm grateful today that I get a check every month from the church. And I'm grateful that they sign my check every month and the check doesn't bounce. Are you hearing what I'm saying? But please understand, I work for a higher power. God is my ultimate employer. God gives then my work eternal dignity. The Lord is my motivation for service, and the Lord should be our motivation for excellence. So if we're going to make a difference in our world, a difference in our communities, if we're going to progress, if we're going to build upon our past and do something well, we must do it heartily. Do it with all of our might. Do it with all that we have. Do it with excellence, because excellence matters to God. And so today, I have 3 points I'm going to share with you. Then I'm going to sit down. that I believe will help you achieve excellence. Number one, everybody say purpose. Purpose. Come on, say it like you mean it. Say purpose.
Purpose.
All right, let me tell you something. God has a plan. And everything happens according to God's sovereign plan. God's plan was in place before the foundation of the world, before you were even thought of, before your mom and daddy got together. Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Before thou camest out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee to be a prophet to the nations. God has a purpose for your life. It's not by happenstance that you're here today. It's not by chance that you're here today. It's not by coincidence that you're here today. It's not just, hey, it happened that you're a student at Lee University. It's all according to God's plan. There's a calling on your life. God has a calling on you, and there's nothing that anyone or anything can do to interrupt God's plan and purpose for your life. Now, if you don't believe me, understand the biblical role says a Red Sea couldn't stop God. A lion's den couldn't stop God. A fiery furnace couldn't stop God. No wine at a wedding couldn't stop God. No food on a New Testament countryside could stop God. God will quicken whom he will, when he will, where he will, and how he will, and God is God, which means God is sovereign. God can do what he wants, when he wants, where he wants, how he wants, and God doesn't have to ask you or me for permission to do as he wants. God has a purpose for your life. God has a plan for your life. I've learned over the years that many people aspire to what they see up front. So because people see a preacher up front, they want to be a preacher. Because people see an actor up front, they want to be an actor. Because people see a musician up front, they want to be a musician. And so people, because they aim for the position up front, we have people operating outside of God's purpose because they want to do what they see rather than what God sees. Everyone wants to do something that they think is significant because they believe that if they do something that is important, that will make them important. But all that glitters is not gold. What's on the outside may not be on the inside. What you see may not be what is. Understand, you can have more titles than space to put them, more degrees than a thermometer, more letters behind your name than the alphabet. But if it's not what God has for you, you will be nothing but sounding brass and tinkling cymbal. Be careful of wishing you were somebody else or something else. Because in my life, I've never known anybody who was unbelievably powerful who was not equally painful. No battle, no blessing. No pain, no gain. No valley, no victory. At an early part of my life, the Lord has entrusted me with major responsibility. And I don't take it for granted because the Lord can give and the Lord can take away. But I've learned in my life that people always want your power, but they never ask for your pain. And if you're not willing to carry my cross, I tell them, you can't wear my crown because my crown is created by the intensity of my cross. God, what have you called me to be? God, what do you want for me in my life? God, what is your purpose for my life? If it's to be the best pastor, then be the best pastor. If it's to be the best doctor, be the best doctor. If it's to be the best lawyer, be the best lawyer. If it's to be the best engineer, be the best engineer. If it's to be the best accountant, be the best accountant. Just be what God would have you to be. People ask me all the time, Carlton Byrd, what do you want to do in life? What ultimately do you want to end up doing? I just want to be the best Carlton Byrd that God would have me to be. Because what God has for me, it is for me. And let me throw this in. When you know your purpose, it will make you a target. When you're trying to practice and epitomize excellence, you will become a marked man or a marked woman. Understand, I've learned, the brighter the light is, the more you attract bugs. Whenever you're doing something for the Lord and fulfilling God's purpose for your life, there will always be an element that envies what you have, will plot against you and undermine your efforts and reputation at every turn. This element is a part of the process, but keep your eyes on Jesus. Know your purpose. You're working unto, not unto man, but unto God. And whatever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord, because I'd rather be blessed of God than blessed of people. Number two, after you know your purpose, you got to then prepare. Everybody say prepare. So we're saying purpose, and now we're saying preparation. If you're going to achieve excellence, you have to prepare. You will never receive what you're not prepared to handle. Every day you wake up, you have to realize that in that day is filled with potential and possibility. Procrastination is your enemy, because procrastination wants to stifle your growth and keep you from obtaining excellence. God has called you to be the head and not the tail. The world around us is moving, it's progressing, and the people of God must also move and progress. We cannot be in the same place we were 10 years ago. We cannot be struggling with the same issues we were struggling with 5 years ago. Too many of us have motion, but we don't have any movement. We've got to be prepared. Lifelong learners. Furthering our education. When you finish your undergraduate degree, don't think that's the end. We must continue in education. We must continue in professional development. It's good, but also I want to throw this in. A part of education is experience, exposure, and enhancement. You can't sit back and let the world get educated, exposed, and enhanced, and think you don't have to do better yourself. It's interesting. I don't know about Dr. Harper, but I know in my profession at Oakwood, because I'm on a college campus as well, it's interesting because a lot of people in my profession talk about they've been called. There's a calling on my life. I've been called by God. But then they don't want to go to school. I tell people all the time, just because you've been called to preach doesn't mean you don't have to study to preach. Preaching is not decibel level. If you're going to shout, say something worth shouting about. I tell them, you're not going to go to a doctor. I pray you don't. Who's talking about, I've been anointed. The Spirit of God is upon me, and God has anointed me to do heart surgery on you. Just lay down, and the Spirit of God is going to tell me where to go. No. You're not going to do that. You want to see a degree. Do I have a witness in this place? You want to see some training. You want to see a diploma, license on the wall. You are not going to go to a dentist. Who is talking about the Spirit of the Lord has anointed me to do a root canal? No, you have to have some training. You have to have some integrity to what you're talking about. You got to be prepared. Your value is based on your knowledge. Your knowledge value is increased based on your knowledge. Young people at Oakwood, where I'm at, they always say, they don't pay me enough. I'm not getting paid enough. But you have no control over what they pay you because you refuse to increase your value. But when you continue to increase your value, you make yourself a commodity where you don't need them, but they need you. Your situation won't dictate to you, but you'll dictate to your situation. I tell the young people, you can't live the rest of your life always taking what folk give you. You have to be prepared. And you're at Lee to get prepared. Jesus said, occupy till I come. Prepare. Don't wait for something to happen. Prepare. Make it happen. Prepare. Don't let someone who gave up on their dreams talk you out of yours. Prepare. So we have purpose, preparation, and then finally, number three is proclamation. Everybody say proclamation. Let me make sure you're with me. Everybody say purpose.
Purpose.
Everyone say preparation.
Preparation.
And now everyone say proclamation.
Proclamation.
Now, this is the part of our challenge this morning that I can say at Lee that unfortunately I can't say at every university. Our perspective as Christians is different than other perspectives. Our school here is different from other schools. Our system is not like other systems. Some people we come in contact with will be won through the preached word. Some will be won through the sung word. Some will be won through the taught word. As I shared with you earlier, you have been in the heart and mind of God, destined for a special purpose from the foundation of the world. God, in every generation, calls persons forth to witness by their words and deeds to the truth, the love, the holiness, and the grace of God. There are many individuals today, named and unnamed, who have served God's purposes and dared to speak to God and for God throughout history. But today, February the 7th, God is calling you. God has called you in whatever discipline you're in. He has called you to the work of ministry and has set you aside for the ministering to men, women, boys, and girls, not just for life here, but also in life in the world to come. Your purpose, Lee University students, is more than going to school, it's more than getting a degree, it's more than getting then a job. We have been called to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. So go tell it on the mountain, over the hills, and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ was born, that Jesus lived, that Jesus died, that Jesus rose, that Jesus is coming back, that Jesus saves. Go proclaim it, go preach it, go teach it, go tell it. Go tell it to your classmates. Tell it to your teachers. Tell it to your family. Tell it to your friends. Tell it to your neighbors. Tell it to your colleagues. Go tell it that Jesus Christ is coming soon. Go tell them that only what you do for Christ is going to last. Go tell them that it's okay to love Jesus. Go tell it. Jesus told us to tell it in Matthew chapter 5. When Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. And as salt, you have purpose in culture." In other words, friends of mine, as Christians, we're not here to adopt culture, but we're supposed to be change agents to transform culture. We're in this world, but not of this world. People ought to know that while we're here, something is going on. When people drive through this campus, they ought to know that there is something different about Lee than the University of Tennessee. They ought to know that we're here to change the corrupting culture that's around us. The only reason why the world has not fully collapsed is because you're salt and you're in the world. Maybe you don't understand this, so let me make this practical. Remember, salt decays the decaying process. Let me say that again. Salt retards the decaying process. Salt retards the decaying process. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth." Back in the day, when a piece of meat was brought in, salt was placed on that meat to purify that meat, to penetrate that meat, to preserve that meat. It would be the salt that would keep the meat fresh and healthy for another time. People back in the day did not have refrigerators. So when the people didn't have refrigerators, they would have their meats packed with salt and they would put the meat in a holding place, and the meat didn't decay. The meat didn't destroy, because salt was purifying the meat, penetrating the meat, and preserving the meat. Somebody's gonna get this in a minute. The only reason why our world doesn't stink and spoil is because you're in it. Take the church out of the world. Take Christians out of the world, and the world is going to fall apart. The world isn't destroyed because I'm here and you're here. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth." And if you can't get excited about that, it might be because you aren't real salt. Because you do know they have a thing called salt substitutes. Looks like salts. Tastes like salts. Smells like, I feel like preaching now, smells like salts. But it's not salt. In our world, we've got a lot of folk that look like disciples, walk like disciples, pray like disciples. They can even praise like disciples, but they're not disciples, because the true test of a disciple is this. If you're salty, then folk around you ought to get thirsty. thirst after his righteousness, thirst after his truth, thirst after his love, thirst after God's power. We need some salt. Lee University, we need you to be salt. You're salt, and you're in the world to make people salty. Let your influence season people for God's kingdom, because salt is no good if it never leaves the salt shaker. So go tell it. Go proclaim it. We have a great history, a great heritage, a great past, a great legacy. But if we're not careful, we can become so caught up in our greatness that we forget God's greatness and the work God wants to do in us. So go tell it. Jesus said, go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the world. Go tell it. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world as a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Go tell it. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of thy righteousness. Go tell it. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation. Go tell it. Because if God be for us, who can be against us? Go tell it. Because no weapon formed against us is going to prosper. Go tell it. Young people, do your work heartily. Not as unto each other, but unto God. Prepare. Purpose. Proclamation. Know your purpose. Get prepared. And go proclaim it. I don't need to tell you what's going on in our world today. You already know. And if we are not with purpose, if we are not prepared, if we don't proclaim it, we have not done what God has told us to do in being salt to a dying world. Father in heaven, today, I thank you for this time at Lee University. I thank you for our president, our faculty, our staff. I thank you for our church pastor, our campus pastor. And Lord, I thank you so much for our students. Now, Father, I pray that we would pursue excellence. I pray that we would live life and do the things in this world, in this life, heartily as unto you and not unto one another. God, I pray that we would understand our purpose, that we would be prepared, and that we would go proclaim to the world that Jesus loves them, died to save them, and is coming back to get them. But Lord, in the purpose, in the preparation, in the proclamation, I pray that we be not castaways. I pray that you would save us by the same gospel we seek to share with others. And when all is said and done, we look forward to hearing you say, well done. Thank you for this time. May we live this afternoon better than we lived yesterday afternoon. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let everyone say amen. Amen. God bless you. It's my prayer.
Stand with me, please. Somebody shout purpose. Shout preparation. Shout proclamation. Now go tell it. Amen? Go tell it. What a wonderful word this morning. Amen? I hope that you have received what I've received this morning. Dr. Byrd, I'm thirsty. You made me thirsty this morning. I'm thirsty. Amen. Let me tell you about a couple of things coming up. And then we'll pray our college benediction. Tomorrow, 2 and 4:30, our softball team is playing. I think that's the home opener for them. Thursday, in alternative chapel in the Conn Center, Andrew Smith, who is a double amputee from some time that he spent in the military, is going to be with us. That will be the alternative chapel, but you don't want to miss Andrew Smith's story. A Lee grad, our alumnus of the year a couple of years ago, just a wonderful testimony. And then Thursday also, liturgical chapel in the chapel. Once again, would you just help me tell Dr. Carlton Byrd how much we appreciate him and how thankful we are for the word. Amen. Be thirsty. Be thirsty. Amen. Let's pray. Now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. God bless you.